From the backstretch at Saratoga, this is Loose on the Lead with Steve Byk and Seth Merrow. Loose on the Lead is sponsored by Thoroughgraph, everything you need to win. Visit Thoroughgraph.com. The new Colonial Downs and the Virginia Equine Alliance. Hill and Dale, home of perennial standouts. Curlin, Kitten's Joy, Midnight Luke, and emerging stallions, Violence, Byron, and Army Mule. Visit hillanddalefarms.com for consignments at the 2019 yearling sales. Case Supply, the kitchen and bath professionals across upstate New York. Showrooms in Syracuse, Auburn, and Amsterdam. Make your dream kitchen and bath a reality. Visit casesupplyinc.com. And McMahon of Saratoga, standing breakout stallion, Central Banker. Number one in New York and among the nation's leading young sires. Visit McMahonThoroughbred.com.
Good morning and welcome to Loose on the Lead. This is actually show number two, but as the meet begins, it's show number one kind of officially. Last week was a nice little kickoff. Seth Merrow, Steve Byk, good morning.
Good morning. I thought you said the lighting was better now.
You don't think that's... Yeah, that's good.
I don't know. Let me see how I look. That's what counts.
Man, you look great. You look great. for folks who can't see, we added a little...
You should see what's going on here.
Yeah, just because... It's funny, being a guy who owned a television production company myself, with the sun in the background, and folks... Some folks say... And I think it's because we have the porous screen behind us, which cuts down on the sunlight. But some people say, is that real back there? Yes, it's real back here.
It's not like a green screen. It's right? This whole operation, it's just like in Jurassic Park. We spared no expense.
some new lighting for this week, so we look even better. We're actually a little late, so why don't we get right into it, because there was a race yesterday that was a lot of fun. You guys were in it, and your horse ran pretty well. I called up the replay for that. It was the second race yesterday. Minute Mouse is going to be the number six horse. You can watch the chicklet, because Minute Mouse is towards the back as they come into the stretch. I thought as they came into the stretch, she was going to make a nice run. And then kind of flattened out a little bit, but came on nicely. You'll see her get up for fourth.
I don't know if she flattened it.
She's at the far left, right here, with the
lime green blinkers. You wouldn't give him 3 cents for her to get a check. And then all of a sudden, in the late stages, you know, it's 5.5. And
boom, she gets up there right on the wire for fourth.
She ends up fourth, and very encouraged. 52 buyer. It's her career best. And you know, there's a little bit of a horseplay, you know, ticket structure suggestion in here. That whole field, if you go back, if you still have yesterday, go back and look at that field. The whole group, you couldn't have really separated by maybe 5 lengths. And this was only her third start on turf. She's a courageous cat. She had been rained off a couple of times. We ran over the winter just to get her some shape. And for some reason, she's 80 to 1. No reason for her to be 80 to 1 in that group where everybody is kind of interchangeable. These are New York bred maiden 40s going 5.5 on the turf. So just don't read too much into morning line in these kinds of races. I write and I say all the time, the New York bred company invariably has got some of the best returns. We've seen it here in the first 3 days. The Charlie Baker horse on opening day. Yesterday we had a pair of them come through with big, you know, with big numbers. So invariably these horses are really well matched, and especially when they're looking for allowance. When you're talking about the New York bred first and second level allowance and the optional claimers, you can throw a blanket over them. So if you see a horse that's not taking money, don't get hinky about it. If you see something you like, go with it. Yesterday, Special Story. I keyed off of Special Story, and to me, you know, has much chance as anybody, and it ends up being a $24 horse. Same thing with Charlie Baker the other day. All you had to do on opening day was project take the posse. All you had to do was project if he translates to grass, he's absolutely as good as anybody in here. And sure enough, So I thought there was a couple of little lessons to be gleaned, particularly already these first 3 days when it comes to state bred.
And I want to mention on this show, I talked about it on the handicappers report, but speaking of lessons to be learned, if you've learned them and you think you have a couple of prices today, low rollers contest today. And the low roller today, the winner gets an entry into the Saratoga Challenge later in the meet.
Very so, nice. Bonus. That is a nice bonus.
And if you haven't played before, jump in and give it a shot. $40 gets you a $30 card, and $10 goes into the prize pool. You have to make five $2 win place and show bets during the day, and hopefully you wind up on top of the pool at the end of the day. Jump in.
Seth has done.
I did. I'm now a two-time.
He's the king of the low rollers.
Low roller. I got the one down at Belmont the other day in a limited field, but it was still fun. Still put it on the resume.
You were like an MTO.
Oh, you'll like this. Last night, Meadowlands, I'll brag on myself a little bit. There was a big card at the Meadowlands, so we did some special cut-ins. I taped them yesterday afternoon. Meadowlands, 7 for 13, 3 cold tries. Wow. I'm giving up the morning stuff. I'm shifting to the evening.
Were you playing?
I played a little
or
bit.
Or was it on the sheet? On the.
We did cut-ins that were on the network last night, and the plays were on the sheet as well, on the OTB sheet.
He's a multi-breed terror. How about the Greyhounds? There's still another few months left.
I like them when I'm down in
Florida. So do I. I love them. High-lie?
I've never done high-lie. I have never done high lie. I have to admit, I'm a little dicey on the
Chulo. What is it? What do they call?
Is high lie still going?
Sure, high lie still going. The goofball Churchill is trying to replace their obligation to run at Calder with high lie. They're talking. They've already built it. Actually, they've built it's not a fronton. It's like a wall. It's like handball. And they're what they're
like
trying
a
to
wall
do.
In a parking lot.
Pretty much. That's exactly right. They're trying to get away with replacing. Under the rules of the paramutual licensing, they want to run 30. Highlight cards, and what they'll do is, this is like what they did down at down in Miami. They did the same thing where they brought in the University of Miami football team and taught them how to handle a Cessna, and they passed that off as highlight. It's unbelievable. The same thing, with those goofy barrel racing up in northern Florida. They're doing it just so they meet the obligations of the licensing. I tell you, it's not easy.
Florida's fun. All right, let's shift back to New York and talk a little some stakes action. Hit on some of the other stakes yesterday too. As we get into the show, you can give the guest lineup though for today.
Our lineup?
Yeah,
Eddie Kenneally, who we know is over here. Absolutely, we saw him. We saw him.
I say that because you were about to point him out earlier.
Yeah, when I pointed that direction, it was Eddie Kenneally. He's magically delicious.
Who had the winner in the Standford yesterday?
Yes, he did, and was also involved out in the Midwest on the day. And Joe Bianca, longtime friend of mine, and Joe is a TDN. Has got really a educated understanding, an educated approach to the game, not just from handicapping, but from the business side and from the industry issues at large. So we'll talk to Joe. He actually was up. He wasn't working for TDN this weekend. He was up to see Dave Matthews last night with his girlfriend. And so I said, do you want to come do the show on Sunday? So Eddie Kenneally and Joe Bianca.
Very good. Those are coming up. We'll start things out, though, with a little stakes action.
Well, do you want to get Eddie in? Do we want to get Eddie in as soon as possible, or do you want to get a couple of things done?
Either way. Yeah, either way. I mean, Eddie's here. You want to take a break and bring him up?
Yeah? Yeah, you think so?
Yeah,
all right, Brian, that's what we'll do. Let's take the quick first break and get Eddie Kenneally in here so he can get back to the business of training horses. But Eddie Kenneally starts off the trainer conversations. When we come back, Loose on the Lead, just getting going.
got it. Watch me. I got it. Hey! I got something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got a move that tells me what to do.
In a recent study of some of the top online wagering sites, Capital OTB won big in total player rewards, far surpassing some of the best-known wagering sites in America. While other rewards programs simply offer you points redeemable for gift cards, Capital OTB's rebates are paid to you in actual cash. Plus, Capital OTB gives you full and immediate access to your money. So if all you're getting now are points and gift cards, join Capital OTB Player Rewards today and get cash back. Visit CapitalOTBBet.com and sign up today.
Welcome back to Loose on the Lead. Seth Merrow and Steve Byk, and as promised before the break, joined now by Eddie Kenneally. Good morning.
Morning.
And congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Nice getting the win in day three of the meet. Let's jump right in and take a look. The Standford Stakes yesterday, by your side, will be the number five horse here, getting it done. Chart margin of three lengths as the 7-5 favorite. This was start number two, the career debut, middle of June down at Churchill. Nice gutsy nose win to start things out. So now 2-2. Was the game plan right after that win down at Churchill to shoot for this?
Yeah, I think it fit into the schedule really well, and that's probably the main reason why we opted to run in this spot. Plus the fact that it was coming up with a short field, and you think you fit on paper with the rest of them that were in there. So that was another reason why we brought them up here.
And again, the number five horse here. Take us through your thoughts on the trip and the result. As I say, in the stretch, is going to pull off nicely to be a convincing winner in here.
I was happy with where the horse is positioned in the middle part of the race because even though he broke sharpest of all, Irad elected to allow the speed horse from the inside go to the lead. So now we had a target, and we were content to sit and stalk that target, which was perfect. And he rode him with a lot of confidence, and it made me confident.
And obviously sat off the pace a little bit in the career debut, and that's nice. A lot of times these two-year-olds are precocious, show some speed, so there's a lot of question marks. But this horse now a couple of times has kind of sat back, had a target, and then made that nice late run, so that gives you a lot of opportunities. Have you thought about what's up next?
Yeah, I think he should continue to improve because of his mental status. He's so calm and relaxed, and his pedigree says he wants to run a little further, and I would think the way he trains and the way he does everything so far would indicate to me that he would be as good or better going longer. So certainly the hopeful at the end of the meet is probably one of the targets. There are other spots as well that we'll look at, but that's certainly one of them.
That's what we like to hear.
Yeah,
Eddie, this is also, we should note, your second Sanford in what, 3 years?
In 3 years, yes. We won it 3 years ago with a similar setup, a horse that ran one time at Churchill in June, won impressively, came here and won the Sanford. And it's working out pretty good. And we've had some nice two-year-olds over the years, but I think this horse shapes up really good with any of them.
Well, and of course, the horse 3 years ago was Batuman, and he's still running. He's still out there hitting away and has had a nice career.
Yeah, he didn't develop into the horse that we had hoped he would after the Sanford.
But useful.
Absolutely. But hopefully this horse will just go to the next level again and continue to thrive.
Nice. And, you know, looking at the pedigree by constitution, so, you know, one of these situations where you've got a new sire and you kind of, you know, are learning as you go as the runners are produced.
Yeah, the sire looks like he's gotten off to a great start, and They're big, pretty horses. I have another one at Keeneland training at the moment that hasn't run at all yet, and he's pretty special as well. So it looks like this horse is off to a big start, and I think he could be one of the leaders at the end of the year of the freshman sires.
Watching what happened the first 3 days of the meet between you winning this and Doug O'Neill running 1-3 in the Schuylerville on Friday, and Doug has had now building up a record of coming into town with two-year-olds at the beginning of the meet. It's kind of interesting, and New York has been trying to build up the juvenile program, but it just feels like, particularly Mid-America, between Keeneland running two-year-olds in April and Churchill with the program now and with the purse situation at Churchill, it feels like you guys have got a bit of a head start when it comes to meeting up with our two-year-olds on the Eastern Seaboard.
That's exactly right. I don't know what the deal is with New York two-year-olds, but certainly the Kentucky two-year-old races fail, and there's lots of them that fail, all through April, May, and June. There's not nearly as many two-year-old maiden races run in New York during that same time period, and I'm not quite sure what the reason that is, but it's working out for us.
The New York team, Martin Panza, and the racing office has been trying to develop that program, including the bonus for the Tremont and Astoria, and it just, I had this conversation with Dave Brennick around the time of Belmont, it just hasn't really gelled, and I don't know if it's a question of just habit and practice by the horsemen or what it is, but not only are the two-year-olds coming in hot here from Churchill, but the horses in general, it seems, from Kentucky, so the last several years it's been a mixed bag. I mean, some of the between Brendan Walsh, sure, and Dale Romans and others that kind of came in and struggled a little bit. Mark Cassie, for a couple of years in a row, Cassie struggled, and he's trying to change it up and figure out a way to have a better Saratoga meet.
I think the Kentucky horses this year are even stronger than previous years now, and I think that's partly to do with the purse structure in Kentucky is getting really, really good, really good, and therefore the competition at Churchill Downs was pretty strong this spring meet, and I think Kentucky horses will hold their own here during the course of this meet.
That leads in perfectly, because I looked at your Equibase stats and pulled up a race from June 28th down at Churchill, maiden race for the two-year-olds, and Noose is going to win this one. Noose, again, the number two horse, wins by a chart margin of 5. It's field of 12 here. So to run away and win by 5, this was a pretty good-looking debut effort. What's up next for Noose?
Noose could be the real deal. He won a maiden special weight first out, going 6 furlongs at the end of June at Churchill Downs, overcame, maybe didn't have the best trip, was full of run down on the inside with no running room for a large part of the race. When running room did open up for him at the 8 pole, he immediately got up in there and won very impressively. And he's a horse possibly for the Saratoga Special.
Very good. I'm told our video froze. We'll try to get that up in a minute, because I want folks to take a look at that. It was a pretty good looking debut effort, and I wondered if he might show up here in the next time.
Yes, we're hopeful that it's certainly on the schedule, and it's a possible race for that horse. And he breezed on Friday at Churchill and breezed really well, so he's in good shape.
Very good.
Mm-hmm. I guess we're getting a little video now.
And again, he is the two horse Noose in here. So, and as you said, they attract the big field, so that's got to feel great to be in a field of 12. And again, he was sitting kind of mid-pack or up in the front quarter of the field for much of the race, but pulls away in the stretch, chart margin of 5. But again, a field of 12, so you have a horse that's a little bit battle-tested.
Very well-bred horse. I trained his mother. She was third in the Schuylerville here at Saratoga. Just a really nice horse, big pretty horse by Morton Reddy. Maybe go to the grass at some point as well with him. You could do anything with him. He's pretty special.
And boy, when we got the cut of him galloping out, he's got the real Morton Reddy body. Kind of that little of everything, middle distance, sprint if need be, long on the grass. He could do anything.
Yeah, got a great constitution, very sound horse, very straightforward. Just an exciting horse.
Eddie, I want to go back for a second to yesterday's winner. Talk about Brad Anderson and about picking this horse out and the purchase. $240,000, which you would think feels like a substantial sum for a first crop sire that didn't necessarily have the big reputation coming into the sales season.
That's true, and oftentimes it's a gamble when you spend a lot of money on a freshman sire, because it is a little bit of a lottery. A lot of the freshman sires do not make it, and it's a little bit unknown which one of them will fail and who's going to be successful. And but this horse physically looked the part, and he is a beautiful moving horse, and that's why we had to pay so much for him. He was one of the higher constitutions at auction, but he was the best that I had seen, and we kind of zoned in on him, and we were fortunate to get him. Brad Anderson, who owns the horse, loved them when we showed him to him. Peter Kerwin did some shortlisting for us, and he was on Peter's list, and he stayed on that list right till the end. And again, we were very fortunate to get him, and delighted to have him.
Him as an owner too. How recent? I don't know much. The name didn't jump off to me.
We've had horses for Brad for 4 years approximately now, and he's been a real good client. He doesn't have a large stable. He actually has three horses in with us right now. One is getting a little time out, and the other two both won stakes yesterday. And the
Parler's his too.
Parler won a stake at Delaware yesterday.
In Glasgow. Both,
yes, indeed.
Oh, that's
and
a good day.
Yes. So Brad's two horses that are in training both won stakes yesterday. And we have Lady Kate, who's a Bernardini filly, who's also stakes placed, coming back in this next week. She had a little setback during the spring, and she's an exciting filly for the fall.
Lady Kate, and that's Brad's first graded stake win.
This horse yesterday, by your side, is his first graded stakes win, correct.
Very nice.
Yeah.
How many did you bring up, Ed? How many do you have here?
We have eight here at the moment, okay. And we're moving horses in and out of here. Going forward, we've got some more horses in Kentucky that we're going to rotate in here over the next week or so. And we'll be running quite regularly. We did run quite a lot of horses this past meet at Churchill Downs. So a lot of horses are getting freshened up right now, and you might see some of them here in the middle part of the meet.
You know, one of the things that has been a discussion with us on the radio when it came to the horse population and decision making by connections, by horsemen and owners, the $50,000 purses at Ellis. How are you portioning out what two-year-olds you're going to keep in Kentucky? And, you know, it's very attractive to come here and run for $90,000. But at the same time, 50 is a respectable enough purse. You know, it was a little different when they were running for 40 and even less in recent years. But Ellis has stabilized very nicely. And, I see Cassie running. Dale's been running a long time. McPeak runs, plenty of his babies start out there as well. How do you decide what you're doing as owners?
Well, the owners have a big input on where they want to have their horses race, and I just give them the information, and then they kind of decide from there if they want the young horses that are getting ready to run right now, if they want them to stay in Kentucky and race there. It's a good circuit now, and like you say, the purses are good enough to make you want to stay if you need to. And then if somebody else wanted their horse to be in New York and race around here, we're happy to do that too. So it's really up to the owners. But Ellis is a good alternative to July and August now. There's a spot to run a nice horse for a good purse without having to run against the best in the nation at Saratoga.
Exactly.
Saratoga is known for bringing some people into the game, and so when we're here during the meet, I like to use this to introduce trainers to people who may be new to the game, and it's always fun to, if you know some of the personalities. So for folks who aren't familiar, talk a little bit about how you got into the game.
Well, I grew up in Ireland, and
Ireland? You're from Ireland?
I am indeed. Absolutely. But I've been around horses all my life, and then I came to Kentucky to further my education and decided to stay in the horse business in this country, and worked on the track as an assistant trainer for Tom Skiffington, a New York-based trainer, for quite some time, and that led me to setting up my own business, and it's been quite good, and we're moving right along, and it's going well.
Did you ever go on any bar hops, any pub crawls with Skiff?
I've been to bars, but I've been too many with Skiff now back in the day. When I worked for him, it was all work, not much play.
I got the other thing that you got to talk about, because invariably, if people listen in to background from various various particularly young horsemen, you have proven as a terrific tutor and mentor for young horsemen who have then gone out on their own. Give everybody the roster of guys that you've sent out from your nest.
Well, I suppose the biggest name is probably Brendan Walsh. Brendan worked with me for 4 years as my main assistant, and as you know, he's gone on to do very, very well as a trainer, a grade one winning trainer, and just a top horseman with a very large stable now. So proud to be able to say that he worked for me for a long time and put up with me for a good while, so he's getting the rewards now. And then Tom Morley, of course, a very successful New York-based trainer, worked for me for just shy of 2 years as my New York-based assistant for that period, and he's also gone on to win grade one race and a successful trainer on the circuit. Yes.
Well, and you, part of this is that you've been you've been approachable for young horsemen that are interested in doing what you did.
Yeah, absolutely. We're happy to have new younger people come on board and work with us and get on the program. And yeah, absolutely. And it's satisfying to see them go on and set up their own business and be successful. So yeah, we encourage that.
Oh, and obviously, when you look at the training trees, most often you hear about Lucas and the half a dozen that he begot out into the world, going back, Woody Stevens, of course, as well. Baffert has had his share that he has sent out, but it's one of those real quiet compliments when somebody works for you and then goes out and does well. I mean, and it's a multifaceted thing, because the people that an assistant knows are obviously your existing clients, and so you're willing, in some cases you're willing to let them get a horse or two from an existing client.
Correct.
And then they have to go out and recruit on their own too. I mean, that's what makes training to me the most enviable and the most remarkable part of the game. The fact that you have to be an expert on the animal, on the care and maintenance of the animal, then you have to be a manager of all the personnel, delegate responsibility, teach them the things that are important to you, and then you've also got to be you got to run the actual business. And all the I dotting and T crossing.
Yeah,
and
people don't think about it. It's a small business.
It's not so small. Invariably, it's a big business. And then you also have to be the thing that is the most telling to me. When you start out, for to begin with, most of these horsemen and women, they have the relationship with the animal. It almost precludes that you're not necessarily the best people person, and so to have to go out and break out of a shell in some cases to approach people and to sell yourself, it's a part of the whole industry and the training game that is really not discussed that much, and it's very challenging.
It is true. There's a lot of different areas where you have to be effective. You've got to be a good recruiter, you got to be a good communicator, you got to be able to be a delegator, you got to take care of little stuff as well as the bigger stuff, and there's a lot of different chores you need to do on any given day. So delegation is good. You need to be able to do that, and it's a lot of work. Believe me, there's a lot of work that people might not realize. You think horses are done training at 10 o'clock every day, and people might assume a trainer's day is then done, but not so. There's a lot going on throughout the day, every day, including the weekends.
Well, there's some trainers whose day hasn't started even at 10 because...
absolutely. running multiple horses in the afternoon, and then going out to dinner with clients too. That's tough work too.
That could take its toll. Well, and the whole thing with the night cards too. And this is one of the things that's, I mean, that's grueling. I mean, think about that. Yeah. You train in the morning, and if you happen to be on a circuit that starts in the late afternoon, like Presque Isle or any of the night tracks, or like at Churchill, you know, you might get out of there at 11:30, quarter 12. If you have a horse in the last race, you might not. Some of your staff probably isn't out of there till after midnight.
True.
If then, and then they got to be back the next morning at 4:30. I mean, it's a lot to ask.
It is. I mean, there is a lot of hours that are logged in by a trainer. It's if you're prepared to be a trainer, you better be prepared to put in the hours, because it's a lot of hours and a lot of traveling too. So it's you're on the road quite a bit, and that takes its toll as well.
You know, you ran last night at Indiana. I know it didn't go great in the Oaks, but how have you dealt with the horses that when you know you're going to have a horse running under the lights for the first time? Is there anything that you can do to, you know, because the schedule is very different for that under those scenarios?
I don't know that it affects the horses at all, running under lights. And a lot of our horses train at Churchill Downs
in the early morning, and the lights are on at
Churchill throughout the morning. So I really don't think that's ever a factor. I think sometimes we might use it as an excuse, but and I've heard it as an excuse, but I don't think that's a legitimate reason for a horse running poorly.
So those owners out there, cross off when the trainer tells you, I don't think she liked the lights. Come up with another one.
My opinion only.
No. The best. Have you ever seen Aaron Yagoda's trainer excuse facts?
Tell him. No, I have not.
Oh my God. We got to get. I've got to get a copy of this. Aaron made up a sheet for uncommunicative trainers. And it basically it's a checklist of what went wrong, and so you can just check off what
there's a lot of them.
Pace too fast, pace too slow, jock moved too early, jock moved too late. She was horsing. She was in season. It's unbelievably funny, but it's also very accurate. And Aaron said he sent it out as a joke. I forget what trainer it was. And the trainer started to use it because he just wasn't one of these guys who wants to get on the phone, you know. And that's the other thing. I mean, there's owners, exactly. There's owners that you have to talk to probably three times a day, and you have to know, you know, who, you know, how to deal with who.
Right. I mean, it's there's a lot going on, and you have to prioritize where you're going to be, who you're going to communicate with next, and when you need to shut it off and leave it until tomorrow. Priorities, you know. I mean, you got to take care of everybody. Big owner, a guy with maybe just one horse, they still need a certain amount of time.
What owner's been with you the longest?
Well, we've been fortunate to have Home Wrecker Racing has probably been with us the longest.
And
they've had some very good successes. We've won four Grade One races for them. They're probably been around the longest. Joe Sutton,
absolutely.
Has been with us quite some time, and he's also a Grade One winning owner of ours. And the Lally family, Summer Place Farm, they would probably be our three longest serving clients.
Very nice.
And just before we let you go, I always like to get opinions from the trainers and the owners back here, what it means to win a race up here at Saratoga, particularly a Grade Three like yesterday, Standford.
Well, it's very rewarding to come in here and run in a graded stake at any for any division, Colts, Phillies, older, whatever, to win in your division in a graded stake at Saratoga is an achievement, and that's kind of what you strive for, and you get some recognition, especially by doing it at a track like Saratoga.
Everybody's here.
Prestigious, and everybody notices when you win at Saratoga. So, that's where we aim to be and want to continue to be.
Who was your first Saratoga winner?
Don't remember. It's a long time ago.
Next time I talk to you, which will probably be tomorrow morning on the radio, I'll have that answer.
Yeah. Okay. we'll look it up. We got some time.
there you go. It's a quiet day. Eddie Kenneally, everybody. And you have a website, do you not?
I do indeed.
Yeah,
Kenneally Racing.
Fairly new. It came out really nice.
Yeah, it's not new, but it's been updated.
Okay.
Yes.
I knew.
Yes.
We discussed this. We talked about this last year, I think.
Yeah.
KenneallyRacing.com. And you're doing a little tweeting?
Not a tweeter.
No.
Not a tweeter.
No, that's all right.
Good for you.
Yeah.
That's what I say.
Says Mr. Technology.
Eddie Kenneally, congratulations and good luck by your side. If you elect it, you come back in the hopeful and with Noose maybe in some stakes action up here as well. Certainly looking forward to those.
Thanks so much. Looking forward to it. Eddie, yes, indeed.
Eddie Kenneally, winner of yesterday's Sanford. We'll take a break, come back. More Loose on the Lead right after this. Stay tuned.
Come on.
I want sales reports on my desk by Monday.
Whoops. My bad.
Love racing? RTN brings you every live simulcast on your home television, plus live video streaming and race replays on your PC and mobile devices. To order, visit RTN.tv. RTN, a breed apart.
Where's the best place to find your favorite teams, your favorite food, daily drink specials, and wagering on live horse racing? Legends Field Sports Bar, 711 Central Avenue, Albany. Get your game on day or night with 75 flat-screen TVs, tournament-style pool tables, a private banquet room, and live horse racing. So if someone asks you where's the best sports bar in the capital region, tell them Legends Field Sports Bar, inside the Clubhouse Racebook, 711 Central Avenue, Albany.
You like free money? Well, Capital OTB gives its players plenty of opportunities to cash in. At Capital OTB, there are so many ways for horse players to receive bonus dollars by simply participating in promotions such as our bankrolls, bounty bets, online handicapping contest, and much, much more. Plus, with Capital OTB's player rewards program, you get actual cash back. So what are you waiting for? Log on today at CapitalOTB.com or CapitalOTBBet.com and claim your free money.
We're back, Loose on the Lead, on this sunny, rather nice third.
Beautiful.
What are we up to? Day four?
Day four.
10% of the meat.
Wow. What are we up to? It's only day four and you've lost count.
I'll walk away now and be very happy with the way things have gone up till now. But an early visit from Joe Bianca and your first Capital OTB experience.
Yeah. Finally got my first... chance to sit with the boys. Let's talk.
I love it. Joe has been seen downstate, of course, and in fact helped Metro New Yorkers understand what happened in the Derby, very famously, while the rest of the mainstream world was bewildered.
Yeah, and outraged, very outraged as well.
I think they were. You know what? You know what's funny? If he had stayed up, they would have been outraged. If they took him down, they'd be outraged. It doesn't seem to matter.
No.
There's just. Everybody's mad about stuff.
Yeah. And then the loose horse became a story, and that was crazy. And the next leg, and you know, the mainstream media is just, unfortunately, these days a little bit clueless about horse racing.
Yeah, they got a little bit of a taste of all the oddities that we deal with on a daily basis, and didn't handle it very well.
Well, but anything, no, they didn't. But anything actually, I maintained all through the early portion, the first. Let's say 4 weeks, Derby and after Derby, and you know, a good 10 days after Preakness, that anything that went on like this was positive. Just because it brought eyes, people were just fascinated. Yeah. And I think this also fits the same scenario downstate that we're looking forward to. I had Dave O'Rourke the other day, and I couldn't help but start with the Belmont news and with the starting of the arena down on the grounds for the Islanders. And 41 hockey home games, conventions, musical things, whatever else is going to go on in that building, there's going to be people visiting Belmont Park for the first time. Racing is going to be going on a lot of those afternoons. If they wander out front and see it, you're going to get interest.
Yeah, and I think it opens the door for maybe twilight racing or night racing. And just, yeah, like you said, to have those people kind of milling around the grounds and maybe stumble upon racing where they wouldn't have before, I think that's a big opportunity for sure.
And right now for TDN, Thoroughbred Daily News, how did you become a fan of the game?
So I had a friend who his dad would make bets for us on the Triple Crown races, on the Derby and the Preakness, and that gradually morphed into me making bets on the Triple Crown. And I hit the trifecta in the Funny Side Derby. and paid like $600, which I was
you're in.
I was 16 at the time. $600 is all the money in the world. So yeah, that summer I started handicapping Saratoga. I taught myself how to read the form, and then it just kind of grew from there, and now into a media position. Now I'm a talking head gas bag.
So. What a field it is. The interest though that you've cultivated. I mean, that's one of the fun things about TDN, and really about the three trade journals when it comes to DRF and Bloodhorse and the TDN. There's a lot of bloodstock, and the TDN essentially really cut its teeth as a bloodstock business trade journal. But then, there's a lot going on. I mean, there's handicapping. Steve Chirac and Brian DiDonato, they have the betting challenge. So there's all other areas, and you've struck on a lot of that. You've talked to owner. You've had owner pieces. You've had breeder pieces. I mean, talk about the areas of the game that you didn't necessarily expect to enjoy as much as you obviously do based on your writing.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question, because when I started at TDN, I was pretty much solely focused on the racing part of it and the handicapping. Yeah. But TDN is really like kind of the Wall Street Journal of the racing business. We focus a lot on the business side, a lot on the sales, a lot on the bloodstock. So I really kind of had to learn a lot about that right off the jump. And so that was a little bit of a transition, but it gives you like a more well-rounded vision and appreciation for the sport. But I think we are branching out, and we are doing a lot of different things. And this is a good time for me to mention that this coming week we're starting an in-office podcast. So we had a podcast before where it would be Bill Finley and he would have a guest. This week we're kind of aiming to do like a NPR type thing, you know, how they have like reporters, or the Times has the Daily.
Fresh air, all things considered.
Right. So we're trying to do that kind of vibe for like 20, 25 minutes once a week, just the people in the office, and then Bill too, kind of just chatting informally about the issues that are coming up in racing, new previous races, upcoming races, larger scale issues like the Stronic Group stuff. So we're starting that this week. The first one is this Thursday. I'll be hosting. And so we'll see where that goes. But yeah, so we're trying to branch out and cover all angles for sure.
Take the opposite side of Bill's and you'll be right a lot. Sorry.
In trouble, Steve. I've only been there a couple of minutes.
Once a week, there's going to be some irreverent barb. It's Loose on the Lead for a reason. I love it though. That's great.
Yeah.
I'm excited for you.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Thanks.
Yeah. Seth, say something.
I was still
like a snowmobile on the dirt.
I was still stunned though from. talk a little bit about yesterday. There was some big racing in the country, and this will give us a good opportunity to throw in the Diana replay, which we didn't look at a little bit earlier. But Chad in there, I did Channel 10 Friday night doing the feature race, and they said to me, "So who are you liking the feature?" I said, "Chad." They said, "Oh, wait a minute, you need a horse." You need a horse. I like Sister Charlie. We'll watch the stretch run here, and it will be Sister Charlie getting it done. Nice late debut, so it was a nice performance in the Diana by the Chad runners, and particularly Sister Charlie on the cover.
Well, we'll keep an eye on Secret Message, who Trevor McCarthy butchered. I mean, butchered.
This was kind of funny because there's only two other horses in the race, and they had to enter the one to mess up the three. So they only wanted to have four out of the five horses. Four out of six wasn't enough. So, I mean, it worked out. Like, they completely eliminated Mitchell Road. And I thought really no excuse for a rushing fall. I thought at the eighth pole she kind of had the run of the race and just got run down by a better horse, I think.
Well, this mare is just, this is a special, special mare.
She's good.
I wrote yesterday in the handicap, my handicapping page, I didn't get the whole meme about, well, Sister Charlie may need one. What is it about her career and about Chad's training that made anybody think she was going to need one?
Yeah, I honestly think that's one of the more underrated parts about Chad, is he has these horses ready to go off long layoffs. You know, even Todd sometimes you'll see will give them a prep, but Chad usually has them ready to fire no matter what.
No, and she, I mean, in terms of timing, how is she not... I mean, I guess in the betting shops in the UK, you could bet the Breeders' Cup filly and mare turf ahead of time. But I mean, how is she not 3 to 5 going, you know, for that. Just should be a natural.
Yeah, and I think the Diana actually had 9 furlongs. It's probably a little bit short for her.
Absolutely. So exactly. Good point. Yeah. Good point.
Speaking of taking the lead in a division, I'll get your opinion on the 3-year-old division so far, which to me is totally up in the air. Code of Honor and the Dwyer maybe now moves into a good position, but I think coming up, Haskell, Jim Dandy, Travers, hopefully, and certainly Pennsylvania Derby have kind of kingmaker status.
Well, as before Joe answers, why don't we watch the LoSalle Derby and watch Game Winner, because that was a shot across the bow. I mean, to anybody who was wondering if Game Winner was going to come back and immerse himself in the second half argument.
The number one horse in the four horse field.
The answer is yes. Yeah. Joe, go ahead.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, it is really wide open now, and this wasn't much of a group, but I mean, you have to respect all of his credentials, and it's probably the right kind of easy prep for the second half of the year. I personally right now would put War of Will slightly ahead just because he's got the Preakness win and he's got the previous graded stakes wins. I don't. It's gonna be interesting to see how voters treat the Derby, because technically Maximum Security was 17th in the Derby, but I have a sneaking suspicion that a lot of voters are still going to consider him the winner of the Derby. So I think he will have a leg up if he wins the Haskell and then maybe performs well. I'm sure if he's going to the Travers, but I would say War of Will is like slightly in front now, but it's wide open and it makes it more fun because you got big fields. You know, he's going to be ducking anybody. You know, every opportunity is golden. So
yeah,
it should be interesting.
If you want the Eclipse, you have to show up over
Definitely.
These next few weeks.
Yeah, and I think that kind of hurt Maximum Security a little bit that he skipped the Belmont and the Preakness, more so the Preakness because War of Will won, but yeah.
Well, War of Will yesterday, right? Yeah. With a nice drill, and apparently looked terrific. I was out yesterday morning, but I missed his work. Obviously, watch as he tunes up, and we'll see what Shug does if he's going to go ahead with Code of Honor. My inclination, just reading Shug, and he was on with me on Tuesday. I think he's just as comfortable training up to Travers as
that's what it sounded.
But if the horse is ready to go and eager to run, he's not going to bypass the Jim Dandy
for sure. And he's honestly, like, if you were my horse, everybody always says that. I think his two most impressive races to me were one turn, the Champagne, where he got completely eliminated at the start and ran on to be second behind a Loose on the Lead winner, and then the Dwyer was super impressive coming from last into that slow pace. So I think he obviously can't bypass the Travers if he has wants any chance of winning the 3-year-old championship, but I would be interested down the line to maybe see him turn back to be a long sprinter or miler.
Well, King for a Day is going to be interesting.
We'll
too.
See that very much. Yeah. Very much
where he goes next and what he does off of that win over Maximum Security the other day.
And well, I think one of those, the initial visual impression for me of the Pegasus was that Maximum Security didn't run his A race, but then you look at the buyer figure, he got 102, so maybe King for a Day is just better than we thought.
Well, and the postscript to the Pegasus was that King for a Day early on in that barn was supposed to be one of their best 3-year-olds. And so for him to kind of take that natural next step, it wasn't seemingly unexpected from their view. So the fact that he kind of forces himself in. Are you going to next week? You going to Haskell?
No, I'm actually gonna be working. I'll be back at Saratoga at the end of the month. But I was asked to work next Saturday, and I forgot that they changed it from a Sunday to a Saturday. I volunteered to work. So
so you're in the
in the office.
You're doing
yeah.
production.
Yeah. No, I'm be in the office writing up races and stuff.
Okay. Yeah. Because you surprised me. I don't know when this was, maybe like a year ago or so. How long are you there now?
About 3.5 years.
Yeah, so close to 4 years. Yeah. And you said you were doing part of the responsibilities included the mock up and doing the technical work to produce the pages to produce the actual. It's not a magazine. It's a what's the form? What do you even call an online format like that?
E-magazine. If it's E-magazine? Online, everything has the E in front.
E-magazine. E-newsletter?
E-newsletter. I would go someplace. Is there a technical term?
What do you guys call it?
We just call it the PDF.
The PDF. Okay, there you go.
Yeah, a little technical. But it's one of the cool things about TDN is that everybody pitches in doing a little bit of everything. You know what I mean? We're small. We have 8 people on the editorial staff. And so everybody has to have a role in every piece of putting out the paper. The paper. Cool. That's what you call it.
The paper.
The paper at the end of the night.
Exactly.
So, yeah. So
exactly. Tell you what we'll do, because we're going to end up running out of time. Let's do the other results, and you can comment along.
Okay. Sounds good. So we have looked at the Diana and the LaSalle Derby. Why don't we pull up the Indiana Derby from last night? It was a field of 11, and it will be number 11. Mr. Money getting it done. Gray Magician runs second. Math Wizard runs third in here. Mr. Money was the 4-5 favorite.
I'll tell
you, it done pretty convincingly.
What a job Brett Calhoun has done with this horse. And he sort of re-engineered him back to the one turn, and now he's, you know, spoon-feeding him, stretching him back out.
Yeah. And he, I wasn't expecting that kind of performance in the Pat Day Mile, for sure. And I think, if you were being honest, maybe he wasn't expecting that kind of a dominant performance. But once he did that, the doors really opened for him the rest of the year. And this was kind of a brave effort with that loose horse on the outside of him. So he earned it.
You know who ran sneaky good in there and had a, it was kind of a weird performance, was Gray Magician, who was bottled up down inside, had horses all around him the whole time. At one point, looked like he was backing out of it. Then he came again and finished, you know, solidly. The figure came back good, actually. I put the figure up this morning.
And I will mention the loose horse was asking for it.
Oh, that was sad.
The partnership,
it felt terrible.
Joe Christofek, and I know there's a
Brandon
couple of
Staubel. Brandon Staubel is the brains behind that operation. And picks the horses out.
There was a couple of local guys that were involved. They were looking forward 100. To the horse yesterday. Stumbled at the start and lost the ride.
Yeah, 100 buyer for Mr. Money, who single-handedly is putting up points for Golden Sense.
Yeah, and how about Golden Sense? Like, I felt like he kind of got off to a little bit of a slow start as a freshman sire, and then kind of just rocketed from there. And he seems like one of the bargains right now over at Spendthrift.
Oh, there's no doubt. Did we do the Oaks or not?
No.
All right, but let's at least mention Larry Jones with these fillies. It's really strange. Street Band, nice performance in the Indiana Oaks. This is an Istan, so it's Larry Jones and Brary Jones. And Sophie Doyle. And you got to give Larry Jones a lot of credit. He was one of the early supporters of Rosie Napravnik. And here he is giving Sophie Doyle, you know, a chance on a graded stake horse. Well done. Elsewhere, Brad Cox, who was a little crazy
busy. We do have
busy.
The Del Cap, so if we want to look at that,
yeah,
we can take a look at that.
All right. All right, I was just going to say, as we go to the Del Cap, Brad Cox with a pair of wins. Pioneer Spirit won that Schaefer at another big effort. This is a horse I came to like down in New Orleans. And he also won the Mary Hillman George with that nice Curlin filly, My Lady Curlin. Sean Bridgemahan in town today to ride Break Even. Bridgemo with two wins yesterday. And, of course, as we turn our attention to Del Cap and beautiful Delaware Park, Jose Ortiz.
Number 7, A Lake gets it done, is the 30-cent to a dollar favorite in here. Chart margin of 4.5, so pretty easy win for the Belmont trainee.
How about 4 stake wins for the J.O. down in Newark? Unbelievable.
It just shows the strength of the New York colony. It seems like anytime these guys go out of town, they just clean up. It doesn't really matter where they go. You know, Javier sometimes goes out to Del Mar and wins grade ones. Jose, obviously, 4 stakes wins. Luis Saez does well when he goes to the shore. These guys are just the top of the top, and I think they prove it more when they go out of town even than when they're riding against each other.
And you saw it under the wire, won by a chart margin of 4.5. The chart says in hand, the last 16th of a mile, he's barely doing anything to get that 4.5.
She was riding him the last 16th of a mile.
It'll be fun to see where she goes. I would think up here at the end of the meet, right? I didn't read
the
any
personal
race
personal ends in. Would have to be right.
Comments, but you would think
maybe we can get another controversial personal ends in.
There we go. We got to gonna have to find somebody to play Abel Tasman.
Yeah.
But
somebody in the bumper cars.
You know what? I think the scales have evened out for Bill Mott on DQs. I'm going out on a limb
for life probably. Yeah.
And anybody who bet Country House is 65-1.
I don't think we've got Arlington, but we can certainly mention Million Preview Day and Jack Sisterson, who's suddenly running up the graded stakes score. Jack Sisterson doing very nicely with the Calumet horses and some of the other, you know, little Hazarai that he's put together. Julia Foxtrot, Brad Cox won the Modesty. The American Derby, I was trying to get War Film in there, and then another of the 15-1 shots ends up winning Faraway Kitten. And Mike Maker, after a slow first third of the year, suddenly he's running up a bunch of scores in these turf stakes. And then there was also, speaking of Baffert assistants, Owen Hardy won the Hatouf with Indigo Gin. So those were your stakes action around the country. And Michael Dickinson, if you didn't notice, won the Matron up at Woodbine.
It was funny. We were up for the Queen's Plate, and right after the Queen's Plate, he grabbed the jockey after the Queen's Plate and was asking a little bit about the surface. Getting a little update on his tapita.
Maybe he's looking for an order. Did he pull out the sales book?
A little review on the surface was Mr. Dickinson. It was kind of funny.
I'll always remember about Michael Dickinson when I was first following racing and him giving Guinness to tap it. That's the thing I always remember about the mad genius.
I'll tell you what I'll remember is him admonishing Ed Fontaine in the paddock when he told Ed Fontaine, "You should drop dead at my feet." True story. Dickinson's. I haven't had him on in a while. I'll call him this week to have him on. He was mad at Eddie. Eddie wrote something. I forget what Eddie had written, but he was hot about something that Fontaine wrote.
Trying to stay on the good side.
Unbelievable. No, but I want to talk to him about the surface. You know, the synthetic surface debate is obviously raging. Is going to rage again. Obviously. Yeah. You know,
speaking of which, TDN, before we let you go, you got anything coming up we should be looking out for?
I mean, in just that podcast, I'll be up here the last week of the meet, so we'll be up, someone will be up here pretty much throughout the entire meet producing content. Got great photos, social media going on, so we're trying to have all bases covered here at Saratoga.
How about some of any new hipster hangouts back home?
Oh man, not in Red Bank.
Red Bank's got, Red Bank's all right.
It's a little too bougie for the hipster hangouts. So, yeah. But back home in Jersey City, we're constantly popping up new hipster hangouts.
Now you're
hangouts.
Talking. Now you're talking.
At the top of the show, we said you were over at the concert last night. How was it?
It was good. Yeah, crowd? So many people.
Always.
Yeah, I made it a little bit less fun, but it was a good show.
Dave Matthews last mm-hmm. night, and who was... It was a country. Who's
tonight?
No, Friday night. There was a country act.
They played both nights.
Then it was maybe Thursday night.
Yeah, it had to be Thursday night.
Luke Bryan, thank you very much.
And today is what?
They're all interchangeable. You just take any two first names and just slap them together.
What's tonight is what? Tedesco,
Joey Seth.
I don't know what their name is. All right, we'll wrap it up.
No, we can't wrap it up yet.
I was going to say, you. Well, go ahead.
Well, because here's every Sunday. Starting now, you got tomorrow off, everybody.
Yeah, right.
And you got Tuesday off.
Yeah, you're absolutely.
So, and then there's Tina, who's got every day off. But I want to give out a couple of ideas that are within, you know, close proximity, and a lot of them will involve food because, let's face it, I'm sort of food obsessed. For those of you that don't know the area very well, the county to your east is Washington County, and it's very historic. It's where we live in Greenwich. But there's all kinds of interesting things, and
which I didn't know until you mentioned it last year, and somebody had mentioned it to me, and you said you'd sit on your porch and watch it, the tractor parade at Christmas.
The Christmas tractor parade. I mean, we're not having it this month, but if you want to come back, if you want to come back late November,
I wanted to bring that
December.
Up for people because I'd never heard of it.
No. Now,
this year, I think I have to go. It's the lighted tractor parade.
Well, yeah. I mean, well,
let's be honest. Of course, we can say of course.
Well, if you live in Washington County, there's a tractor parade any day you're driving around because there's probably one of those gigantic things that you could almost drive under. I don't know what those. It's like, it's not a combine. It's something else. It's like way up high. You ever see those?
Yeah, I know what
it's
you're
got these gigantic
about.
Wheels about the size of the tent, and you almost, if you had a Fiat, you could drive right under the thing instead of having to go around. No, I'm going to send you out to Shushan and to an absolute treasure that if you have not been, a lot of you are going to have heard this name. It's Yushak's, Y-U-S-H-A-K apostrophe S. It's in Shushan, and there it is. It's been there for 75 years, and Denny Yushak and his family, Denny is the third generation, and it is, I mean, it's a great little grocery store, and people out in Shushan and Salem and out in the middle of the country, they'll go there for some groceries, but what you go for is Denny's unbelievable meat. Out of this world. He, first of all, he does a corned beef, a hand-rubbed 17-day age dry corned beef that is unbelievable. But all of his meat, and I should have taken a picture of the cuts. Last night we had fillets. Ask Gary Siaka, who's as discerning as there is. Ask Siaka how he liked it. there's so I could go on and on about what he's got going there. He'll custom cut things for you. He'll do custom grinds. They have an unbelievable fresh the breakfast sausage, maple, apple, regular. Kielbasa. Last night we had fresh kielbasa. They hadn't even smoked yet, so I had to do it on the grill. Ushak's in Shushan. You'll be thrilled. And you tell him I sent you. He and his brother and everybody out there, they all are huge fans. They love the horses. They love coming here. They've been coming their whole lives. And while you're out in that direction, as I mentioned last week, Moses Farm in Eagle Bridge, where Grandma Moses lived. She was actually born in Greenwich, but grandson Will Moses, you got the farm stand, and they grow their own corn. Everybody knows BJ and Hand in Greenwich, but go out to Eagle Bridge, Moses Farm, another terrific option. We'll keep feeding these out to you. It's almost blueberry season, so you're going to go to Winnie's over in Skylarville. It's, Cobb Hill, I think. But we're going to give you all kinds of nice ideas for places that you've been too busy over the years to visit.
And just before we go, I noticed you have, did you want to mention the event? Right there in front of your computer, you got the...
Thank you very much. Good point. Again, this year, delighted to be the MC for an Unbridled Affair. And this is Captain that does such great work for families and for children in the Capital District that are just, you know, at risk in so many different arenas. Captain has been associated with the racetrack for many, many years. We're going to have a lot of fun, I think. It's a week from Thursday at the City Center. And when we were trying to figure out what horse, you know, usually there's a horse and a horseman that are honored. And they said to me, what do you think? And I said, well, how about the 30th anniversary of Easy Goer taking the Whitney and the Travers? So we're going to honor Shug McGahee and Allison and Easy Goer, New York's Easy Goer, on the 30th anniversary of his special, special summer. Be happy to have you join us. And if you go to the website, and I want to make sure I get the address correct on the website because it's got a funny little.
If somebody types in, I would assume on Google, Unbridled Affair Saratoga.
Well, no, I know, but I don't think it's just captain.org. I think there's something more to it.
But you did a wonderful job last year as the
MC. Right, you came. That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
It was a. They have a silent auction. Also, it's definitely one of the many charity events during the Saratoga meet that are worth checking out and thinking about.
CaptainCares.org. I knew there was a word in there that I was missing. An Unbridled Affair Gala, CaptainCares.org. Come and join us. One of the really nice annual events, and it's nice and early in the season.
All right. Joe Bianca, Thoroughbred Daily News. Check out his work. Appreciate your stopping by.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate
Travel safe back home. Eddie Kenneally, we appreciate his stopping by as well.
He's Seth magically Merrow. Delicious.
And Steve, I like when he said, I'm from Ireland.
Really, Eddie? Ireland.
Seth Merrow, Steve Byk, every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. So make sure to mark it on your calendar throughout the remainder of the meet.
And if they miss it?
If they miss, our YouTube channel, the Capital OTB YouTube channel, all the shows are archived as well. So check it out there. 1250 on your Spectrum dial, but you can visit the website as well, the brand new website. Click on that media link. Watch all the morning programming.
While you're there, check out Seth's bottle cap challenge video that he did.
Those all look fake to me. I don't know how you do that with your foot. I think the cap's just sitting on the top of the bottle. I don't think people are actually spinning it off.
Did you see the one with Mariah Carey?
I don't know what this is at all.
You missed this? No. How did you miss this last week?
I don't know.
Week?
I'm young and viral, but...
It's videos of people somehow knocking a bottle, spinning a bottle cap off of a bottle.
With their foot.
With their foot, trying to kick it. How about the woman that flipped the flip flop?
I don't think I saw that.
That was hysterical, and she.
We don't have the video.
Well, I should get the video. I stumbled upon it myself, actually.
I only know because some television show showed a bunch of them. Otherwise, I also would be a little clueless. You would have brought up the bottle cap challenge, and all of us would have been. But yeah. I did happen to see it, so I'm hip. I'm up. You were making fun.
That's
of me,
you.
Earlier. All right. Once again, reminder. OTB, the race book, there's a couple of promos today, so keep that in mind. 7-Eleven Central Avenue in Albany, and up here, Low Roller Challenge. They're a lot of fun, and today, the winner...
Beat Seth Merrow.
The winner, I'm in, because today's winner gets a ticket to the Saratoga Challenge later in the meet, so jump in and play Low Roller today at the track. All right, wrapping it up, Lucid on the Lead for this Sunday, every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. We'll see you next time.
From the backstretch at Saratoga, this is Loose on the Lead with Steve Byk and Seth Merrow. Loose on the Lead is sponsored by Thoroughgraph, everything you need to win. Visit Thoroughgraph.com. The new Colonial Downs and the Virginia Equine Alliance. Hill and Dale, home of perennial standouts. Curlin, Kitten's Joy, Midnight Loot, and emerging stallions, Violence, Byron, and Army Mule. Visit hillanddalefarms.com for consignments at the 2019 yearling sales. Case Supply, the kitchen and bath professionals across upstate New York. Showrooms in Syracuse, Auburn, and Amsterdam. Make your dream kitchen and bath a reality. Visit casesupplyinc.com. And McMahon of Saratoga, standing breakout stallion central banker. Number one in New York and among the nation's leading young sires. Visit McMahonThoroughbred.com.